up, y'all? First of all, I'm so upset because I already recorded this and it said error uploading, so I have to do it all over again. But this time, I'm going to do it live, so my footage will be saved. So, Ms. Devoted Tiff, this is my page, this is my channel. I am here to talk about Real Housewives of Potomac, episode tonight, season 5, episode 9. Got my notes, let's go. So, the top of the episode starts off, we get to see how the fight unfolds. We learn some facts. The first thing we learn is, looking at the full footage, Monique blacked out, Candiace did not touch her, and Candiace did not throw the wine on her. We do see what Candiace does antagonize her, and she does say, you gonna drag me, do it. And that is typical trash talk, pre-fight, banter, whatever. You say all of that, and you wait to see who's going to take the first move. Now, these grown women with kids, with businesses on national television representing the culture, that could have just ended at trash talk. But Monique is a self-proclaimed girl from the hood, and she took it there. Now, every once in a while, we get really upset. There are things that we consider fighting words. Somebody talking about your mama, talking about your kids, talking about your man, calling out your name. None of those things happened tonight. All that happened is, she says, you're going to drag me, do it. Don't drag me, do it. And then Monique proceeds to flip her hair, to flip Candiace's hair. And we know at this point she was doing it to get a reason to take the first swing. She thought, when she flipped Candiace's hair, that was going to get Candiace to touch her, and then she have an excuse to swing on her. We do see a hand, but it is a light hand. It is not Candiace's hand, but I don't think Monique even saw that, nor did she care. She was just waiting. As soon as I feel like she put her hands on me, I'm about to go. She admits that she blacks out. The scene looks crazy. We were able to see there was no obstruction of view like there was at the end of last episode. You couldn't see, like, who was sit where, how close she was to each other. No, it was clear. She pulled her kind of across the table. The table slides, glasses break. Monique will not let go. The amount of cameramen and I swear every person on that production staff in the place was over at the table. It took them and all of the girls. They maybe said 15 to 20 times, Monique, let go, Monique. Let go. She was not letting go. She was grabbing on tighter. We see Candiace try to get a couple of like licks in, or like try to like tussle back a little bit. It was no go. She had such a tight grip on her. We eventually hear Candiace say, I'm bleeding. Get her off of me. And the girl literally yelling at her. They're trying to grab her hand to pry it off, and she is just not letting go. Finally, she lets go. They pull Candiace to this side. Candiace tries to, like, come back for a minute. But I think that was more so of a pride thing. She wanted to try to get her lick in because this lady been holding on to her hair for, like, all this time. And she couldn't do nothing but lay there. And they take Candiace to a room. And so at this point, they take Monique to a room. And at this point, we see Monique, the thing that stuck out to me the most, she had zero remorse. Like, she was still talking trash. Well, yeah, that's what happened. She said, you know, she wanted me to drag her, so that's what happened. We do see out in the other room, the girls, except for Ashley, are definitely just, like, blown away, disappointed, upset about what's just happened. You could tell that Karen feels in the middle. She's trying to figure out, well, let me go check on Monique. Ashley is saying, she shouldn't antagonize people. She shouldn't be antagonizing people. Like, girl, stop. As much antagonizing as you've done. So we see Karen go, and the producer has Monique in this room. He will not let her out of the room. She's still in there talking trash. Karen knocks on the door, and she's like, they're like, who is it? They're like, it's Karen. I'm here to see about Monique. They do not open the door, not even for Karen. I think they could tell at that point Monique was still kind of riled up, and she wasn't planning on calming down anytime soon, and that she would have literally went back out there and tried to do a round too. So The other thing that stuck out to me is we also see that Gizelle and Robin were clear, like, I blame Monique, we don't do this. Actually tried to say something about there was glass thrown, and that she said she did it because Candiace threw a glass. And Bravo, of course, with the receipts, they play it back, and we see that at no point the glass fly did Candiace come across throwing the glass, throwing the wine. Literally, you just see her almost like holding back this way and her head getting pulled this way. Like, so Monique was trying to use that as her defense. Can't do it. Debunked. Done. Dead. So they take Candiace to a car to try to get her headed home. And Monique is still in the room with his producer. And I don't know how she got away. It didn't seem like they was coming after her. But she was like, well, I'm going to go out this way. And so the door is right here. She heads this way and around the corner. She ends up outside. As soon as she gets outside, she runs, takes off to the van that has Candiace in it. The producers and security are having to grab her and stop her from getting to the van. They usher Candiace off. And Monique is like, let me go, let me go. And they're like, she's gone, she's gone. She's like, oh, she's gone, let me go then. They let her go. She goes inside to the girls, and still no remorse. Even though she admitted she done blacked out and all this, she's like, y'all better keep her away from me because I'm a killer. So now we done went to threats of killing her. And the whole thing is crazy to me because, again, there's certain things that even though you shouldn't fight and put your hands on people, it'd be fighting words. But she's literally upset at Charisse being invited to her anniversary party, which she apologized for. And she's upset, I guess, about her pulling Ashley to the side during her activity of the bonfire, or the fire pit, which she also apologized for. The only other thing she has to be mad at is after she was really sideways with with Candiace, at the leg house, that Candiace then decides, well, I'm not going to do the podcast anymore. None of those things are worth a grown woman fighting about. So disappointed. Morning after, we get the different reactions. Wendy is first. She's with her daughter. She's getting ready to do her commentating. And she kind of speaks from it from the view of, first of all, she said she didn't sign up to do this. And she's saying, you know, I go on these shows, I commentate, and I'm always championing those, you know, of us, like black people, black women, that don't never necessarily get a voice. And sometimes the reason that they don't is because people look at them in a certain way. And so what happened was just like another notch in the belt for them to say, see, that's why, that's how they are. That's why we don't do this with them. That's why, you know, we feel this way and that way about them. And so, even though we're not supposed to be representing the whole culture, that's kind of how it is. And unfortunately, like, I agree with Wendy, like, this just took us some notches back, like, yikes. Then we go over to Gizelle. She's with the girl. They're getting ready to go to Atlanta. The restaurant that Jamal has purchased for them is going to have this grand reopening under the new management. And Robin calls her. They talk a little bit about the events the night before. They are both very adamant. This was all Monique. We all talked trash, but she took it too far. Gizelle was like, I need some answers. And, you know, she was letting her know that they're going up there to do the restaurant thing. We go to Candiace. She with Chris. He brings something to drink. He's like, how you feeling? She was like, you know, my head is tender right here. And he's like, you know, you got a concussion, do you? Like, you need to go to the hospital? She's like, no, I'm fine. But she tried to take it like a little bit. Like, you know how some people, when they get hit, they just, oh, fall to pieces. Oh, I need to go to the doctor. You know, I need this medicine. I need to press charges. And they do this whole thing and try to, like, really play it up and kind of soak in the moment, you know. And she was just like, no, I'll be okay. And Chris brought up a good point. And they also didn't say it. They talked on her way home, as did Chris and Monique. And he was saying, you know, you could tell that she was hurt, not just the physical pain, but that the emotional pain from it had to be horrible too. Because you could tell that she did see Monique as a friend when they cried and hugged the last reunion. And even when she had the conversation this season with Ashley, she was saying, you know, this is like my friend, and I hate, you know, why is she treating me this badly? Like, we were real friends. We were like sisters. And, like, why is she treating me this badly over like this, you know? So, that was that. And I will say Bravo showed those apologies, and it just proves all the people that are saying their team Monique, like, Candiace really has been the classy one throughout all this. Yeah, she has, like, you know, Robin was saying, she has a mouth on her. You know, she can be a little intense, you know, during an argument when she's trying to make sure she gets her word in. But, like, she will apologize. If you sit her down and try to have a mature conversation, she will sit down and have it with you and in a regular, level-headed voice. And so, like, they always saying, and when he's always trying to paint the picture of, you know, she's just always a trouble starter and this or that. But, like, Candiace is super mature. So I hate that, I love that they showed the receipts of her apologizing, but I hate that Monique is trying to paint this picture of her. So then we go to Karen, and the saga with her and Ray trying to rekindle continues. She's having a chef come over. She wants to cook for Ray for, like, his birthday. And even in that scene, like, I feel like she is so sassy that she don't even realize, like, how it can come off. Because, you know, he was like, you know, he was trying to communicate, you know, she be trying to get him to say he missed her and love her and all. And he's trying to communicate, hey, I like this, you know, I miss you cooking for me, you know. And she has to soil that moment and say, don't get used to it. Like, for you to be saying you're trying so hard to get things back, like, why, you know, flirt a little back with him. Don't say it, don't get used to it. Be like, you know, hey, you play your cards right? Yeah, I'll do this again, like. She was, even in that moment of preparing for his birthday, then of being a nag, I hated to see that. She also has that conversation with him about a life coach. She's like, well, I know we don't do therapy. And I'm like, girl, do it. Do it when you can do it. And she's like, I know we don't do therapy, but maybe we can consider a life coach. And he seemed, what I liked is that he seemed engaged in that idea. He wasn't shutting it down. He was asking questions. And it seemed like she was taking it as he was, like, unsure about wanting to move forward with it. But he seemed to me very open in that moment, which is a good thing. And so I hope that that means that they can work it out. So while they're doing the dinner, she tells him about she was invited to her high school to be a part of the homecoming. And I thought she was going to say, and I was thinking about, you know, you coming with me, you know, like a little mini vacay or whatever, get the fire going. And she was like, I was thinking about inviting the girls, you just hear the record scratch in my head, like, okay, girl. And she's like, but I can't. And so she went ahead and told him what had happened. And he was asking, well, you know, what caused that fight? What got it to that point? She's like, I honestly don't even know. And she also told him about what was happening with Ray, what was happening with Michael and Ashley, and that Michael admitted that he went up in the room, but he didn't sleep with the girl, and Ray wasn't buying that. He a man, he know, he was not buying that. And he was kind of, I promise you, Ray is the shadiest person on out of all of those housewives and husbands. And he was like, basically trying to say the only reason that it didn't go down is because he was up there and, you know, he couldn't make it happen. And she was like, well, did we find out about him liking men or not? So that was that scene. Come back from commercial. Gizelle has arrived in Atlanta with the girls and they come to a hotel. And let me know y'all's thoughts on that. I was so confused by that because I was like, if my man stays here, we got kids together, clearly the kids have some rooms at his home, why are we coming here and staying at a hotel? She says that the reason is because since the kids are still not comfortable with them being in a relationship, you know, she thought that would be the best. I still felt like that was weird because if they have their own rooms there, I mean, it's Jamal Bryant, I'm sure that it's not like just his room and then their rooms, like, seemed like it would have made sense if they're trying to be this new family that she, to keep the kids from feeling more comfortable, could just sleep in another room or something. Like, that whole thing was was weird to me. But she also lets us know that her dad doesn't know about her being back with Jamal. I was surprised about that too, because I'm pretty sure she said in the past that he watches the show, he loves the show. And they talked about that last reunion, because Andy asked her and she confirmed. And so I was surprised that he still didn't know. So she said she's going to tell him. So that should be interesting. Cousin Andy, now I know good and well you do not watch no Real Housewives of Potomac. And that's what I'm talking about on here. Anyways, share a tag if it's somebody that you know watch the Housewives. So we go to Monique and she's at home. And Chris comes downstairs. He's just saying that he is disappointed. And she still doesn't have any remorse for how things went down. And you can tell she told Chris a little story, but not like a legit full thing. She tried to make it seem like they were fighting. And Chris was like, oh, I hate that, you know, you guys were, you know, hitting each other, fighting each other. No, Chris, no. It was all your wife, no matter what she told you. She lied. It was basically one on her, not each other. Not each other, okay? And so, she, even though he was saying that it bothered him, or that, you know, image and stuff like that is important, and, well, yeah, of course it's going to sound like blah, blah, blah to you, Cousin Eddie, because you don't watch the show. Bye. Yeah, that's my cousin. So she, even with him saying that, she was like, well, I know that it's important to you, but it's not to me. But my thing is, like, it should be. Like, first of all, you a mom. You know, you're always bragging about this great life you have, these homes, this loving husband, but you still got enough whatever anger, remorse, whatever you're feeling, to kind of take all of that and hit somebody. Like, if I had me a good, fine husband and this beautiful home and this beautiful family and my businesses, and somebody gossiped about me and I knew it wasn't true, and it wasn't even the person that I fought, it was someone that person invited to a party, that's not going to be enough for me to want to hit them. I'm like, I got this amazing life. Like, I'm not even going to be bothered by you, you know? So that, I could talk about that all day, and I'm not. So we go back to Atlanta. Gizelle and the girls have dinner with her dad, saying, you know, they're excited about the restaurant. It'll be a good experience for them. She sends them off to the bathroom, and she finally tells her dad that her and Jamal are dating again. And he was a little hard to read, you know, like sometimes the older men have that really good poker face. And she lets him know, and he was like, well, you know, as long as you're happy. But he didn't say it like he was excited or anything like that. He just kept it really cool. He's like, as long as you're happy. And I wasn't sure what to think of that. Then we go to Ashley, and she is with the fam. They put baby D down to sleep. She's saying in the interview, well, I love that they're not talking about Michael anymore. They're talking about this whole Monique and Candiace mess. But I'm still bothered with what Michael did. I'm 60% want to stay and 40% want to leave. But I think that's the first time she admitted she still was kind of on the fence about staying with him. She's always like blindly believing him. And so she sits down with him and she's like, you know, we haven't really, really talked about this and kind of like where we are. And he admits that he feels like, well, the intimacy had changed. And always seems like men bring that up, but you got the lady pregnant. You think you having to deal with issues. Imagine having to spend 40 weeks with a whole nother human inside of you and changing your whole life and your body. If she can deal with that and still not go out here being reckless, then you should be able to deal with any changes in intimacy enough to not, you know, go cheat on the woman that's carrying the baby that you put inside of her. Like, y'all are supposed to be such the stronger vessel or whatever, but I don't know about that. Well, actually, I do know. Y'all not. And this kind of thing proves it. So she was like, you know, this has happened, and like you didn't abstain, and you said before that you would and you wouldn't. And he was like, well, it won't happen again. And she said, well, you said before that you would never and you did, so how do I know basically it won't happen again? So we learned that their prenup is done because the prenup was only for 5 years, and if they got divorced within the first 5 years, since they didn't, that's gone. There's no agreement now. But by law, the default ruling would be if they got divorced, it'd go 50% down the middle. But she wants to now have a post-nuptial agreement. Basically, in case it was time to go to court, and since the 50-50 isn't technically in writing, he could still fight against it. So now she wants a post-nup, so that if he does this again, she let him know, I'm going to be out, and I want to make sure that me and the baby going to be good when I'm out. And so he actually agrees to it. He's open to it. So that was cool. So then we go to Gizelle, the girls. They're at the restaurant. They're getting a tour. Of course, Grace is being her anti-self. I love me some Grace. And they're going around the restaurant and seeing what it looks like before the big day. And Grace is like, oh, it smells. Oh, it's cold in here. Blah, blah, blah. And so then they go back to Karen, and now they're meeting with, it's actually a friend of hers that has a radio show that talks about relationships and stuff. And I was like, dang, I wish that she wouldn't have went to somebody that she knows. It needs to be a neutral party, but the lady ended up being okay, in my opinion. She asked him some good questions. Ray's issue was that he feels like she doesn't have good balance, and that basically, things aren't like how they used to be. And she says that she doesn't feel like he is intentionally dating her. But I didn't really feel like she was hearing him. Like, he was legit saying, you know, you used to cook more often. You don't do that no more. And intimacy, it may be before just the wind will blow and I'm ready. Now I need a little more revving up. And I don't feel like she's really trying to be on her end of things, romantic and kind of, you know, flirty and stuff. Just like in the scene that we saw, she was giving him a hard time, and so they're kind of like not on the same page anymore. And but they're there, they're talking, that's good. He ends up saying, well, it seems like, you know, I loved how you cooked for me, and that was like a thing that our family did, but once the kids left, you stopped cooking and made me feel like you never cooked for me. I just happened to be there, but that you were actually cooking for the kids. And again, he's telling her now, he's articulating his feelings. I hope that she was hearing him. I can't say for sure that she was. And then when the love question came up, he was like, I think I do. But the tone, because you could say it so many different ways. You could say, I think I do. I think I do. I think I do. And I took it as the last one, like he was affirming, yeah, I think I do love you, girl. But she took it as he wasn't sure. And so she, after that was done, like she went up in the room with the producer. She was crying. I felt really bad. I feel like she's seeing a lot like she's the victim in this. But I hope that she's getting from it things that she can do to get the things back excited again, you know, like. The one thing he's saying for sure is just more balance between this new business venture and being a wife. And I really hope that work it out, you know, because over 20 years is a long time, and sometimes things change and you just got to adjust on both sides. So then we go back to Gizelle. Interesting to me that they didn't arrive together. And also interesting, you know, this is the first time that it's them and Jamal with the dad. The restaurant opening seems to go well. The girls actually getting their hands dirty and seeing the different jobs around the restaurant. I thought that was cool. They all sit down to eat together. And when they do, the dad gets up and he leaves. And his mic is still hot. And he was like, take this mic off, I'm done taping, I can't be a part of this, I can't support this. And he confirms for us that Jamal has 3 more kids outside of the marriage, outside of the kids he's had with Gizelle. And he's like, you know, that says a lot, that he would have all these kids outside of the marriage, and he's not feeling too good about it. And I just hope that she would take into consideration, if your dad is like this and your kids is about this, about their own dad, there's still some scars there. And I hope that she just looks out for herself and just, you know, keeps her eyes open, is all I'm going to say. So, yeah, it was a good episode. We see next episode, they're going to confront Monique. And that should be very interesting. So let me know your thoughts. This is going to be on YouTube and Instagram as well. Thank you for attending my live and chatting all things Real Housewives of Potomac Season 5, Episode 9. If you watch this later, give me a holler. Let me know your thoughts. And y'all have a good night. Bye.